Economic development in Greater Reading on BCTV is supported by Fulton Bank.
Hello, and welcome to Economic Development in Greater Reading. My name is Pamela Shook, and I'm the Vice President at Berks Economic Partnership. One of the reasons we thought it was important to join the BCTV family and produce this program is so that we can make sure that Berks County residents are aware of all of the different facets of economic development. Today, one of those facets that we're going to be talking about is part of the educational system, specifically Reading Muhlenberg Career and Technology Center. And joining me today in the studio are Jerry Whitmer, who is the Administrative Director of Reading Muhlenberg Career and Technology Center, and Erin Kostenbader, who's become an important part of the BEP team for the summer while she's interning with us, and she's also going to be acting as my co-host today. Jerry, without further hesitation, I want to really get into talking about the importance of vocational technical training. And it's gone really, you'll hear us mention later, it's really gone beyond what we believe is the traditional vo-tech. And we really want to hear about some of the career pathways that are out there and available to Berks students, because as we know and have been experiencing, it's really critical to the business community that we're trying to attract to Berks, and also the one that's here already. Jerry, now tell me, you've had a lot of renovations out there. I was really quite surprised when we visited. It's quite a modern facility.
Yes, it is. We concluded in 2004 with a modernization project that added about 50,000 square foot to our facility. We currently have 31 programs supporting 7 different career cluster areas. Our students have many opportunities. Students who attend the Reading Muhlenberg Career and Technology Center come from either the Reading School District or the Muhlenberg School District. We also have students who live in those districts but attend Holy Name and Central Catholic. So there is a wealth of opportunity for students who are looking for career and technical education. About 37% of our students beyond high school pursue a post-secondary education opportunity, whether that would be at a trade school, going for an associate's degree, or possibly a bachelor's degree. So our school provides many career pathways for students interested in learning how to work with their hands and learn skills that are applied to the workforce.
And can you talk a little bit about any of the partnerships that may exist with businesses? Because, you know, we also learned a lot about the abilities for cooperative work and things like that. I'm not sure that as much of that is done, but there certainly is a partnering with the businesses who need the type of employees who are coming out of RMCTC.
Absolutely. We really appreciate the partnerships that we do have. You mentioned our work-based learning program, our cooperative education, I believe. We have quite a few students who go out on job shadowing opportunities, we go out on clinics, and also cooperative education, which is a paid experience that students are able to go out and work a half a day. So all of those partnerships take working with our business and industry community to provide those opportunities for our students. So without those partnerships, without that help, our students would not have those opportunities. We also run a career day that's a big event in the spring of the year. We partnered with Junior Achievement, the Society for Human Resource Managers, and the Home Builders Association in running that activity this year. We had well over 50 employers involved in that activity, about 90 students, and also many employers participate in an industry roundtable at our school, where they come in and present classes to our students to just help our students understand a little bit about what's expected when they leave school and go into the workforce. So we appreciate those partnerships.
Mm-hmm. Throughout the course of the program, if you have any questions for our guest, please feel free to call BCTV. The number will appear at the bottom of your screen, 610-378-0426, and we welcome any questions that you may have. We'll also be showing a brief video as well of some taping that we took at the school, so we're anxious to share that with you as well. Jerry, now how many students are currently at the Career Technology Center, and at what grade can you actually enter any of the programs?
Most of our students are enrolled in grades 10 through 12 at their sponsoring high school. We are planning to open next year with about 1,250 students enrolled in our programs. Students who are interested in coming to the Career Center are able to apply during their ninth grade year. Typically, we do our recruiting in ninth grade, although there are some things that go on in eighth grade prior to that, where students have a chance to come out and visit the school. We also run an open house. It's a very informative opportunity for parents to come out to see the school and to have their questions answered. So that's pretty much our process. Students in January start to begin to schedule for the upcoming year in 10th grade, and that's the point where we really target students actually applying to the school.
Mm-hmm. Now, you didn't have quite as many students this year. What's allowing for the increase in the student base?
Our faculty's been working very hard at improving our programs, at taking their programs out into the schools to help students understand what opportunities are available. And all of those efforts have really increased the awareness that our students have about the programs available at the school. We have a new website, www.rmctc.org. There's a wealth of information available there that students are able to access. They can see video of the programs. They can see an overview of the school. So I think the awareness of the school in general has increased significantly, and students are making choices for their future, for their pathway and their career with more available information.
Okay. As I mentioned, we actually went out and visited the Reading Muhlenberg Career and Technology Center at the beginning of June, and we're anxious to share with you some of the taping that we took out there and give you a viewpoint of the school. This really isn't the traditional vo-tech anymore, is it?
No, it's not. And students here can actually go to various different pathways, and a lot of those are determined by our occupational advisory committees. An example of that is in our cabinet making area. Russell Plywood is one of the people that are on our committee, and they have determined that they want our students to come out here specifically being able to coat and do exterior coating on various different products that they have. So they have also arranged a certificate that the students can get here through them. So we work with business and industry to make sure that not only can they get different job titles at different levels, but also that the ones we have are locally needed here in the area.
I'm here in the plumbing and heating classroom at Reading Muhlenberg Career and Technology Center. I'm going to be talking with Mr. Dietrich, who is the instructor for this particular curriculum. And we're going to be asking a little bit about the types of career pathways that exist for these students and some of the certifications that they can actually get out of this classroom curriculum.
One of the changes today in the vocational, the career and technology area is the career pathways, where we specifically set job titles and have these students work in particular areas for certain job titles. Also, one of the neat areas today, one of the most important aspects is accreditation. And we have numerous accreditations in plumbing and heating. We have the NCCER, which is the National Center for Career and Education Research. And that's a national level certification that these students can obtain and earn through the various tasks and modules that they pursue. That's on a national level. We also have the PBA, the Pennsylvania Builders Association, which is more of a local Pennsylvania level. And plumbing can be different when you go from Pennsylvania to Florida to California. So we have the national level, we have the local level. We also teach them the OSHA standards, and they will walk out with an OSHA certification card. And that's vital today because it makes them employable as the day they walk into industry, which is really, really great. We're looking at adding other areas. I'm looking at asbestos training. I'm looking into the new stainless steel flexible gas lines, which is also cards that they can walk out. As they walk into the employer, it's less that the employer has to do as far as training and bringing them into the program.
And I think we're actually going to meet some students today, and you're going to show us a little bit about what takes place in the classroom.
And Juan here is going to actually thread a piece of 3/4-inch steel pipe using the oilless threading machine. Okay, Juan, go ahead. There we have the whole process. The whole process is completed with all the tools on the machine. And is this easier than threading by hand?
Yeah. It's very easy.
That doesn't always work out in the field. At times we're on a sidewalk, we're in somebody's basement, you can't carry this heavy equipment. At that point in time, we have to go to the manual process. This is years old. This equipment has been around for years. And what Mike is going to do, he's going to show us how we thread pipe using the manual processes, which is still used extensively today. This is the same process which we had prior done with the automated machine. This was all done by hand. Mike, which is the easier way?
On the machine.
The machine is a lot easier, but it doesn't always work. As you can see, this is much more laborsome, much more tiresome. It's still used today, and it's where we start. Here we're going to demonstrate a brazing process or hard soldering process where he's going to braze a fitting onto a piece of copper tubing. This is a test machine that we have here where we have a pump set up. We actually pump and move water. We have a flow gauge to give the gallons per minute, and then we also have the pressure gauge to tell the pressure it's operating under. What Justin's going to do, he's going to get a comparison of what happens when the line size is reduced as far as the flow, how that changes, and as far as how the pressure will change. Go ahead. In this situation, Justin will continue to take readings, and then he'll take all that data and plot it on a chart. That way we'll get a good comparison of what happens in the system as the line sizes become smaller. It's a good practical application without having to go out into the field.
One of the things I want to ask you guys is, did you know before you came to the Career Technology Center that you wanted to be involved in the plumbing and heating field?
No, not really.
No, you just knew when you came here?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I knew that I wanted to do plumbing because of all the opportunities, the jobs and everything that you can do out in the real world.
Mm-hmm. Justin, how about you?
Yes, I did, because my brother was a plumber and my dad was a plumber, so I'd rather be a plumber too.
Running in your family,
yep.
Sure.
Well, I really didn't want to come to this shop in particularly. I actually wanted to go to another shop, but they told me to stay here for a little bit, see if I like it, and I love it now.
So you guys are thinking about staying in the area. Are you comfortable with the fact that you're going to be able to find something in the field of plumbing and heating?
Yeah, I'm probably going to go into an apprenticeship program, so yeah, it should work out good.
Yeah, he said the same thing that I was going to say, yeah, pretty much apprenticeship program, so...
Yep, they already took everything I was going to say, so.
Yeah, I'm hoping to work with my brother in the future at his job and get an apprenticeship program.
I'm here in the welding classroom at the Reading-Muhlenberg Career Technology Center, and I'm with Mr. Milan, who is the welding instructor. One of the reasons I'm really excited to be in this classroom is because one of the things that we consistently hear from companies that are moving into the area or who are here and want to expand is that welding is one of the skill sets that they're looking for in their potential employees. So I'm really anxious for you to tell me a little bit about what happens here in this classroom.
Okay, we do a variety of welding applications here at the Reading-Muhlenberg Career and Technology Center. We do MIG welding with stainless steel and mild steel. We do gas tungsten arc welding. We also do shielded metal arc welding, plasma arc cutting, oxyfuel welding and cutting, brazing. So we do a variety of welding applications here. The students also get an opportunity to learn blueprint reading. They also will get to build projects and fabricate, get some experience with the fabrication end of the welding program. So we really do a variety of welding applications that is expected for them out in industry.
So they're getting some classroom time to learn some of the technical things they need to know in terms of, you know, the academic portion of the field, but also the hands-on, which I think is really important, and that's what employers are looking for. Now, you've shown me here today two projects that the students have worked on that they've created out of some scrap materials and products that were here. Can you just point this out? Because I think this is really great how they're able to then use that to create something that's kind of above and beyond the typical classroom.
Yes, we were just scavenging through the one of the shops where they rebuilt, and this was left behind as scrap. And the students looked at this and they thought, well, we see a grill, not scrap. So they brought this in, and we designed it as a grill. They learned the theory behind the welding, because they actually didn't do any stainless steel welding before we actually started this project. Okay. Everything begins in the theory room. Mm-hmm. We spend a lot of time in the theory room learning the principles and the application, and then we come out here and apply it. Mm-hmm. I'm very excited about the fact that these students will be leaving with a number of certificates and certifications. For example, they will have OSHA certificates that they will be participating in for safety. They will have NCCER certificates and certifications that they completed certain programs in that. They will also have AWS certifications. And this is industry certifications that they take this certification right on the job, and if they're welding on that particular type of application and they need that certification, they can start welding literally that day.
Mm-hmm. Tell me how you chose the field of welding.
Well, I chose welding because there's always a job out there for a welder, and it's a pretty good field to be in because there's a lot of money out there for it.
Cody, tell me how you chose the field of welding.
I chose welding because there's always a job out there that you can exceed in with welding, and my great-grandfather, he was a great welder, and I like to follow in his footsteps.
I'm here with Mr. Stock in a computerized drafting technology classroom. If you could just tell us a little bit about what the students are doing when they're here in the classroom, please.
Our students are learning how to operate computer drafting programs such as AutoCAD, Inventor, or Revit. They're doing 2D drawings. They're actually doing 3D models of houses. Anything mechanical, we try to teach them how to draw that. Basically, anything that's made or manufactured has to have a drawing made of it, and that's what we're trying to teach our students how to do here. Yeah, the technology we have in this program is very advanced. It's equal to or greater than what is being currently used in the industry right now. We have high processing computers, we use dual monitors, we're using state-of-the-art software, and we actually have a 3D printer.
They're
gonna show us. Yeah, which actually print anything that you can imagine. You can draw it in 3D, then that machine will print it in 3D. This is a bell that was created. It actually, it interlocks, the clapper interlocks to the bell, and you can create that in 3D, and then it will actually, when it prints it out, it's all in one part. The clapper is actually inside the bell, and we printed that out. I'll show you how it came out. You see how the bell actually comes out. All in one piece. It's just developed at very thin layers, and it just keeps building up until it comes out to a solid object. And you clean it off. It's a plaster-based machine. So there's no dangerous chemicals or anything. You can manufacture just about any prototype of any object you're thinking of manufacturing. This is an early stage of design and manufacturing. You take just about any object that you can think of and create it. The certification they're trying to attain right now. It's called the NACDI certification. That's a basic drafting program, basic drafting certification. Most of my students do go to college from this program. I have over 50% of my students do go on to college to further education. I actually had students become registered architects from this program and engineers. Some go right in the workforce, large percentage go in the workforce. And
so they are workforce
level,
ready.
Right, entry-level drafters.
If there's a specific message that the community should know about the Reading Muhlenberg Career and Technology Center, what is it? I think it's basically that we're changed, that we have rebuilt ourselves, and that currently we are in a situation where we have technology here, we have many different opportunities for students, and it's just not the old Votech that people think of when they think of a career center. It's really different now.
I want to thank you for taking time to open up the center to us and being able to take a look and really share it with the Berks County community.
I would again like to thank Jerry for being on the show, and also Allison Larson and yourself for letting us come into the Reading Muhlenberg Technology Center, Career and Technology Center. Thank you to Mr. Dietrich, the plumbing and heating teacher, and also Juan Madera, Mike Candelaria, Joey Sarge, and Justin Smith. The welding teacher, Dan Milan, and Brian Bashore and Cody Moyer. And also thank you to Ralph Stock, the computerized drafting technology teacher. Jerry, can you just tell us a little bit about the opportunities that are available for community members or adults that they can take at the center, different courses they can take?
Sure. We next year will be starting up an adult ed program where adults will be able to come to the center during the daytime, sit side by side with our secondary age students. In today's economic climate, as everybody knows, quite a few people are laid off. We're approaching a 10% unemployment rate. This is a great opportunity. We are a resource to our community, an educational resource. And so if we have seats available, we're going to make those seats available to adults for training. So this opportunity is available. And, you know, in our partnership with the business community, you know, we're here talking about economic development today. And, you know, we play a vital role in that. We graduate approximately 250 students a year who either immediately are going to go into the workforce or at some point down the road. And the more connections we can make with our economic community, the better opportunities our students will have, and the better our community as a whole will be in the future.
Great, thank you. I heard the plumbing and heating students talk a little bit about going into apprenticeships when they complete the program, graduate. Mm-hmm. Is that something that many students in different programs will do? Is it required, or is it just complementary in helping them exceed in their area of study?
For the most part, apprenticeship opportunities are available to students in our construction cluster of programs. It's a pathway through the unions for students to become employees with the unions. It's just another way that students can access employment. And we certainly encourage it. The unions have been very good to our students. They come in, they bring quite a few students into the organizations, and we appreciate what they do for us and for our kids. So it's just another way for students to access employment.
Great.
Jerry, I really want to thank you for being a guest today on this program, because the Career and Technology Center has really been proving to be a vital role in our business attraction and marketing and outreach efforts, because one of the things that businesses want to know when they're looking to locate here is, what really is the workforce like here? And I think what you're showing is that you're generating a number of career pathways, curriculums that students can come out and be workforce ready, but also a pathway for them to go on to continuing education. And I think it's really important to point that out, that you're offering a real array of curriculums for them to pursue.
Jerry Whitmer, I want to thank you so much for being a guest today on Economic Development in Greater Reading. Erin Kostenbader, my co-host today. Thank you, and please join us again for Economic Development in Greater Reading.
Economic Development in Greater Reading on BCPD is supported by Fulton Bank.